So, final presentation of the day about customer experience, which we usually shorten to CX, but these ladies made it sex, because sex sells. And I sort of added why the customer is always right. I hope that sort of covers the whole thing, right? So I think this is going to be a great talk about why branding and the whole customer experience is about much more than just what we have talked about for the last 2 days, which is the technical part or the communication part. It's much more. It's part of a bigger thing. I think it connects to the opening presentations that we had this morning and the stuff that we did yesterday. So I'd like to ask for a warm welcome, a big round of applause for Deborah and Beate. And I'm going to give the floor to the mic. I'm going to take the mic and I'm going to leave it to you guys.
Okay, do we have a clicker?
Yeah.
So this is the last part of the 2 day API days, and I just heard it should be fun and interesting, so hopefully we'll manage that. No worries. So as Rob already said, sex sells, and on sex in this case with a C from the customer. We're going to prove to you that if you deliver a great customer experience, it will also benefit your company. So first of all, who am I? My name is Deborah in English, or Deborah in Dutch. I work for ABN AMRO. I'm responsible there for the customer experience of our corporate clients. And within ABN AMRO, if you talk about a great customer experience, what we try to achieve is that it's going to be as efficient as possible for our clients, because probably you recognize that it's not that much fun to do financials and you just want to get over with it, so it should be smoothly. But there are certain moments where you really want to make a difference, where you should be close to the customer and really be a strategic partner. So that's what we aim for. And together with Beate, I wrote 2 books about customer experience.
Yes, hello. My name is Beate, like Deborah said. I'm working in consultancy for almost 21 years already. I work at VDW, it's right now EY, Ernst & Young VDW. And the last 20 years, I'm busy with helping companies with their digital transformation and also their customer-centric transformation. And of course, customer experience is a really important part in that. And I think you can say we are both passionate about customer experience. And that's also the reason why we decided to write the book Sex Sells. Deborah was a colleague, and then we got a lot of questions from our clients for customer experience best practices. And then we thought, well, why not write a book about that? And of course, you have to put some theory in the book, and we did that. But besides that, we looked for a lot of interesting cases. First, we wrote a book in Dutch, and then 2 years later, we decided to write a book in English as well. And here you see the 30 cases from the last book. Today, we won't go with you through all the cases, but we see some success factors when you look at cases. Here you see them, and we go through these success factors and illustrate them by a lot of cases. So I think let's start with the first one. Dare to stand out.
Dare to stand out. And let's start with a quote from one of the most famous marketing people worldwide, Philip Kotler. He once said, if you're not a brand, you're a commodity. And that's what our companies are facing today, that it's quite hard, or actually almost impossible, to be distinctive only based on your products. You recognize that probably, that products are becoming more and more similar. So if you want to make a difference, it cannot be in the product. So it should be in what you stand for as a company. What is your brand about? What do you believe in? How do you make a difference? How do you make sure that the customer experiences that he's dealing with your business and not with one of your competitors? So let's dive into the theory. This is a customer journey. Probably some of you will recognize this. Here you see orientation, purchase, usage. So that's are the phases a customer goes through. And for each of these contact moments between a customer and a company, there's a kind of emotion you get as a customer. You can be very happy, or you can be dissatisfied, or just neutral. You go through a journey of emotions. And if it's a moment that is not so important for you as a company, and not so important for the customer, we call that a standard moment. It really doesn't matter that much how the customer feels. But those moments that are so important for the customer and also for you as a company, those are really the moments of truth. And the third moment is about your brand. Those moments where the customer really feels that he's dealing with you instead of one of your competitors, that's what we call a branded moment. And then, of course, the question will come, yeah, what moment should you focus on as a company? And when we ask this to companies, most of them will say, we always focus on the moments of truth, because that's where it really happens. Please let me explain why it's important not only to focus on those moments. First of all, sometimes you cannot even optimize these moments. If you, for example, an insurance company, the moment you have a claim, that's the real moment of truth. That's why you paid all those large amounts of monies all these years. But sometimes you're just not covered for it. So yeah, you cannot really optimize that moment. It's going to be a negative moment anyway. The second, personally, I think that's even more important, is that the moments of truth for your company are also the moments of truth for your competitors. So if everybody is focusing on the same moments, it's still getting harder to really stand out. So think about where do you stand for as a company, as a brand, and how can you make a difference in those moments? It might be a moment of truth where you can make a difference, but it could also be a standard moment with little impact where you can enlarge the impact by making it a branded experience. That's a theory. Let's show some cases. Brussels Airlines, the Belgium airline company, had a lot of troubles with, of course, like a lot of companies, like a lot of airlines, with the low-cost carriers, the Ryanairs, the EasyJet of these worlds. And they were thinking, how can we stand out? And they thought, what we have and what others don't have is that we're Belgium. And we can really create a more Belgium feeling about flying with us, really reunite our country, which is divided by itself anyway, in making sure it's a Belgium experience. And they created this attitude, which they call the Belgitude, and they make sure that customers feel they're flying in a Belgium airline. So Tintin, the cartoon, one of the most famous Belgium cartoons, they put it on the airplane. We fly you to the land of Tintin. And on board, you get the small Smurfs together with your meal for the kids to enjoy it. There's Belgium chocolate, Belgium beers. So really to emphasize, we're Belgium and we're proud of that. And it's really delivering them great results because now, especially Belgian people, of course, love to fly with them. Tony Chocolonely might be more well known, also said we're going to set ourselves apart from our competitors by making sure the whole world is going to be slave-free. And I'm not sure, maybe sometimes you just open the bar and eat it, but if you take the time to look at the inside of the wrapping, the whole story of Tony Chocolonely is explained. That they really want to change the world. And maybe sometimes you get irritated about the fact that the bar, if you want to divide it, you cannot equally divide it because all the pieces are uneven. But that's because the world is not fair. Our wealth is also unequally divided. So they thought about how can we make sure that our brand, standing for transparency, fairness in the world, that it's in every part, everything that we do. They don't have, or they also have an annual report, but they have a fair report explaining what they're working on. And sometimes people ask me, yeah, that's nice, but that's only in the B2C world. So let me also share an example of B2B. GE, General Electric, they say, okay, where we stand for as a brand, what we stand for is like we're a 125-year-old startup. They keep on reinventing themselves. It's about innovation, it's about imagination. And they created this platform, GE Reports, where people from in the company, but also journalists, are invited to share what they're working on and how innovation is making the world better. And they deliver such a high value, such high standards, that these articles are even republished by, for example, the New York Times. So really making sure GE is about innovation. So that's about standing out. Let's go to the second one.
Yes, individual data-driven journeys. And when we talk about data, the data is important for using the for the customer journey itself. So how can we make the customer journey more personal? But of course, we can also use the data for measuring the customer journey. first go into the first thing, and there the question is how to create an individual customer journey. Well, what Deborah said already, we have the standard moments, and when we take the industry into account, we get the moments of truth. When we take the brand into account, we get the branded moments. And then when we take the data into account, we get the branded data moments. And those moments really have the most impact. So it's good to look in that way to your moments. And then when we talk about the data, we always use this 360-degree client view. And I think it's nice for yourself to have a look at it and to look, what kind of data do I know from my customer? And if I don't know the data, how could I gather that data? And if I do know the data, do I use it in my customer journey? And if I don't, how could I use that data in the customer journey? And what we see is a lot of companies just have a little of these 360 data view. Well, I think a company that does a really good job in this is Unilever. What she sees is that people are searching for information about hair care 30 million times a day. And that's really a lot. And that can be questions like, well, it's my birthday, I want to have a nice hair fit, what should I do? And then they decided to create their own YouTube channel that's called All Things Hair. And popular vloggers are asked to give their vlogs there. And that's all based on actual Google data. So they look what is searched for in Google that day, and then the vloggers are creating their personalized vlogs. And I will just show you how it works.
Hi everyone and welcome back to All Things Hair. I'm Freddie from the blog and YouTube channel Freddie My Love, and today I'm going to be creating this really easy festival inspired half up bun style using the VO5 Big Volume Mousse. This style is so super easy to do and we're working in collaboration with E! Entertainment to beat hair boredom. This video is one in a collection of different hairstyles for all different occasions, so make sure you subscribe to the All Things Hair channel down below and check out allthingshair.com to see all the other amazing easy hair tutorials. So, we're starting with dry hair, and we're going to apply a tennis ball amount of the VO5 Big Volume Mousse firstly into our hands, then running it through the lengths and ends of our hair. And then we're going to loosely blow dry the hair using our fingers to comb through the hair as
well. Well, we'll stop it for now. of course, you can have a look further at home. But it's really successful for Unilever, and they're selling their products by the popular vloggers. Well, the other question is how to improve a journey in such a way that the knife cuts both sides, so that it's good for your customer, but also good for you as a company. of course, you have to measure your customer journey, to improve your customer journey. And this is the customer journey measurement framework, and there are six types of measurements in this framework. When we look at the row above, there are the measurements for the single contact moments, and in the row below, there are the measurements for the customer journeys, so a combination of contact moments. Then we look at the frequency, we look at the experience, customer satisfaction, and we look at the impact. And I will dive into that a little bit further. So here you see the customer experience impact metrics, and what we do is that on the horizontal X, you see the customer satisfaction. On the vertical axis, you see the impact on your business objectives. So that can be less churn or more profit or other things, a higher NPS. And then we can plot all our contact moments in this matrix. And the size of the bulbs indicates what the frequency is of the contact moment. And then you get four strategies. When we look at the quadrant A, there are the moments with a high customer satisfaction and a high impact on your business objectives. And that are really your best moments. And there the question is, how can I show those moments to more customers? When we look at the quadrant B, there are the moments with a low customer satisfaction, but a high impact on our business objectives. So for example, when we have an insurance company and people are paying all their whole life to get paid when there is something wrong, and they have a claim and they didn't get paid, they will be dissatisfied. So that can be a moment in that quadrant. And there the question is, how can we increase the customer satisfaction? Then we look at C. There are the moments with a low customer satisfaction, but also a low impact on the business results. And there is the question, can we eliminate those moments? And then in D, there is a high customer satisfaction and a low impact on the business objectives. And then a lot of time we see companies are doing it too well in these moments. They are putting too much money in it. And I think it would be a good idea for a lot of companies to put their contact moments into this metrics and to see what the strategy should be for the different contact moments. Well, we go to success factor 3, the branded services for more differentiation. Like Deborah told already, how to escape from the commodity trap. When we have our product, it's more and more hard to make the difference just by our product, because products are more similar. Of course, we can make the difference with our customer experience. But the question is if that is enough. Should we do more besides our customer experience to really make the difference? And we can do that by creating a branded service. And that's creating, adding value next to our product, next to our customer experience. And that can be to put more loyalty, or it even can be a new business model. I will illustrate it with an example. It's an example from Nutricia, and she wants to give proper nutrition to mothers after the and their children after the first 1,000 days that the child has born. And what they see is that people buy Nutricia products for the first child, but when they get a second child, a lot of times they prefer a cheaper brand, and they go to a house brand, for example. So she wants to create more loyalty to the customers. And then she decided to create more added value, and we will show it with a little film in it, and that's really like a branded service. And she had a really good result with it. What she sees is a growth of 75% in the product purchase for the second child. So I would think that's really a good job and also a higher NPS.
Nutricia wants to be the expert of first choice for mothers. In order to get their sympathy and trust, we invest in the relationship through our digital platform, Mijn Nutricia, a rich resource of relevant personalized information, inspiration, and help for mothers and mothers-to-be, emphasizing that we are a trusted source for early life nutrition. Once we engage with this precious target group through the platform and the app, we can use this contact to strengthen our bond and use it for branded content and e-commerce.
I think a good example of really creating loyalty and like you see with really good results. Number 4.
Yeah, of course, being here at the API days, something about technology may not be forgotten. But of course, it's very important for if you want to deliver a great customer experience to focus on technology. So maybe some of you are already familiar with the whole methodology of design thinking, but what is really important is that you understand what is important to your customers. So you start with the people, but also what's important to your business. What are the objectives you have? What are values? The brand values do you have? And the technology. And if you can find the sweet spot where those three come together, that's where the innovation is, and that's where you can really set yourself apart from competitors. So, in a nutshell, how does design thinking work? Well, it starts with making sure you truly understand what the challenge is about. So you're trying to convert, to diverge, to make sure you have enough ideas on what's happening to really grasp the variety of the challenge. And then you narrow it down again and see, okay, but these are areas where we see some opportunities where we dive into. Then again, you're gonna find solutions for the challenges you found, select the best solutions. And even when you start implementing, you're still not completely sure where you're gonna end up. You still allow yourself to see along the way, how does it fit best? Keeping in mind what's best for the customer, for the company, and what is feasible via technology. So why is it so important to have a methodology like design thinking? Well, it ensures, because you have the creation part and the implementation part all together, so it ensures that you work multidisciplinary, so you have different people working on the problem. It also makes sure that you start with the customer in mind, so you, along the way, in every step of the way, the customer is there to make sure that the end solution is also what the customer wants. You can learn from your mistakes. You can just, as you go, make sure it gets better and better. So it is a higher chance of success, and it's more fun to do it this way. So a nice example of a company working with design thinking is Philips. And one of the things they came up with is the toothbrush for kids, the Sonicare toothbrush, because they found out in their research that for kids, it's no fun to brush their teeth. You have to stand there for like 2 minutes, nothing is happening, it's just annoying. So as a parent, you always have to say, oh, go brush your teeth, and they just don't want to do it. So they created this whole program, actually, based also on an app, where it's more fun for kids to brush their teeth. So already when they are 3 years old, it's a nice app with this cartoonesque person in it, it's called Sparkly. And when you start brushing your teeth, this person does crazy things and he helps you. Oh, don't forget the upper left or the upper right part. And it will count down until the 2 minutes are finished. And then you can collect points. And with those rewards, you can even buy a hat for Sparkly or get him some nice shoes or whatever. You can make it an even more personalized person. So it becomes way more fun for the kids to brush their teeth. And actually, there are some kids now that go to the parents and say, can I please brush my teeth again? Because I want to go to the app. So it's way easier really looking on what's the problem for both the parents and the kids and making sure that you use technology to get there. Another example from the hospitality branch is Marriott, the hotel chain. And they found out that a lot of their customers are business travelers. And well, I know some of you are also from abroad, so probably you recognize this. Is that when you travel, you always fly in late the day before. So everybody's doing that, so you have to queue. Then you go to bed, in the morning you wake up, you take your breakfast, and then again you want to check out, like all other business travelers. So again, you have to queue. And those queuing is of course very annoying because you just want to go to your appointment and well, do whatever you have to do there. So they developed this app where you can already check in at home. You can use your mobile phone or your iPhone, iWatch, Apple Watch, as a check-in device. So you can, well, the picture's not that good, but you can you put your phone in front of the device and then the door opens. You get a notification when the room is ready. So you don't have to wait until noon or until 4 o'clock, but the moment it's ready, you can enter. And checkout is exactly done the other way around, so also easy, not needed to go into a queue. And what's also beneficial from this part is that now the journey from these travelers that normally just go there, sleep there, and leave again, but now they're already starting at home. So while they're on the app, Marriott can already give them some tips where to go to, how to get a taxi, and already help them. And also back home, they still can be in contact with the customer. So they also lengthened the customer journey. And now you might say, yeah, but this is nice, but it's also a challenge because it's becoming more and more technology driven. So yeah, what's the next step? Well, what we see happening, of course, more and more is that machines are replacing people. Another example from that is the Carrefour, the French supermarket. They have this robot called Pepper. Maybe you've seen Pepper before. And this robot is walking there around, helping you to find whatever groceries you need. So it's not that you need to go to somebody who's there, who's working there, but it's just a robot answering your questions, whatever questions you might have. And then you might think, well, okay, what about people? Well, let's make sure that even in the digital era, people still make the difference. So you need to make sure that also your people are aware of the fact how important it is to focus on the experience. And what we always say is that customer experience, it's not a function. Yeah, it's kind of weird because I'm a customer experience manager, but everybody in the company should be customer experience driven. Sometimes people ask me what my goal is. I say, well, I want to make myself not necessary anymore because that's when I do a good job. So you need to make sure everybody within the company is putting the customer first. And that's not limited to some certain functions or certain departments. It's really doing it together. And some companies even go one step further and also think about, okay, but what kind of experience do we want to deliver then? And what does it mean for the kind of people we hire? Because if you want to deliver, for example, a fun experience, you should hire fun people, because otherwise you can never deliver that experience. And employees should be motivated from themselves to deliver that experience. So an example in that one is Pret-a-Manger, the sandwich store. And they even go so that far that they think about, yeah, okay, we have this nice culture with the people here. How do we make sure this culture is going to last? So if you want to work there, of course, there's a first screening, but then quite rapidly you're put in a team and you can work there for one day. And after the day, the other people of the team can decide whether they want to hire you or not. And what you see happening there is, well, that's how people work. You always like to work with people that are more or less the same like you are, because that's easier to work with. So they keep on replicating, actually, the kind of people they already have in place, and they keep on duplicating it. They're becoming more and more. And that's how they make sure that they get this whole culture they have, that it's going to last. So, to sum it up, the five success factors you have to think about if you want to deliver a good customer experience: dare to stand out based on your brand, make sure you're distinctive. The individual data-driven journeys: data is becoming more and more important, make sure you have all the right data and use it. The branded services: go beyond your own journey, but think about where you stand for as a brand and how you can even go one step further in helping the customer in his journey. The technology part: make sure what's happening out there and how you can use it within all these customer journeys. And last but not least, the employee: make sure you focus on the people that in the end, directly or indirectly, have to deliver that experience. Thank you very much.
That's great, thank you so much. We've just been talking for 2 days about number four. The technology.
Yep.
So we're going to next time need 8 more days to get the full picture. Now, I love how you put it in perspective. I mean, we're really, so we've been talking for 2 days about technology and how anything is possible, and the technology is there, and APIs, and you can do anything. And it's so, I think, so important now that companies, but also technology providers, start to think about how to put it to use. Right? Instead of just, okay, we can use it, and let's just do SMS and channels and do everything. Some companies just do all the channels, nice. But start thinking about the experience, because that's what the end result is all about.
Yeah.
So thank you so much.
You're
and
welcome.
Oh, if companies in the room here or in our network need some help with their own, let's say, branding,
they can always
thinking,
call.
Yeah,
we can, always.
Because I think I'm thinking of some companies, but I won't name
good.
Names. Thank you.
You're
thank you. One more round of applause, please, for Beate and Deborah.